Hello and welcome back to the channel. So in today's video, I wanted to give you a rundown about using natural products for hair growth. And I'm primarily making this video because I've seen certain YouTubers trying to profit from people's hair loss in the form of selling their own natural remedies backed by science in order to help with people's hair loss. And I wanted to make this video because things like this really upset me. You know, I don't like people preying on other people's vulnerabilities just to make money. We all know how harrowing hair loss can feel. It's such a nasty thing to go through. And sometimes it feels like there's no clear-cut answers and we just don't know what to do with ourselves when our hair is falling out. And I just really hate it when people prey on that in order to make some money because I just think it's very wrong ethically. And it also really upsets me as well when people use science incorrectly in order to promote the products that they're selling for hair loss. So yeah, this video is a bit of a ranty one, but I'm gonna try my best to kind of talk you through natural products and what the literature says about using these products for hair loss. Many of these studies primarily relate to androgenetic alopecia, which I believe is what most of you guys are going through because obviously, androgenetic alopecia is a lot harder to fix than telogen effluvium. So in this video, I will talk you through some natural products that I've looked into and ones that I think are worth trying and ones that I think are not worth trying based on the science. And for any of you guys that don't know, I've been suffering with hair loss for a very long time now and I was diagnosed with androgenetic alopecia last year. I've been making videos showing you guys myself on my hair loss journey and the things that I've been doing to improve my hair. So, you know, this is something that is very close to my heart and something that is very important to me. You know, I feel your pain if you're going through hair loss. I don't want people taking advantage of you. So this is why I'm making this video. So let's get to it. There's some things you need to know when it comes to hair loss products. Products like minoxidil and finasteride are FDA approved, which means that these products go through rigorous trials and a lot more scrutiny during testing because they are sold as medicines, as medications, whereas cosmetic products are not regulated by the FDA. The FDA doesn't do testing for cosmetic products, and cosmetic products, they don't need to demonstrate their efficacy. The standards of the testing is not as high as products done by the FDA. That's something worth considering. If you're going to buy someone's natural hair product, just remember this is a product that is not FDA approved, and you need to think to yourself when buying things from people, you know, what testing has this product undergone? You know, where is the efficacy? Where is the science? Where is the literature to back up claims about the product? So, you know, I just want you to keep that in mind when you're buying natural beauty products online. You know, what type of testing has this medication gone under in order to prove that it actually works for hair loss? I looked on the FDA's website and it also notes here that the use of natural or organic doesn't necessarily mean that a product is going to be safe. And I highlighted this again in one of my other videos. You know, just because something is natural or organic, it doesn't mean that it's going to be good for you, which is a common mistake that I think people make when thinking about skincare or hair care. You know, I myself have fallen into this trap and it's just caused a lot more damage to my hair and my skin in the long run. I'm going to talk about some natural products and their use for hair loss, for hair growth, and I will link all the studies that I mentioned in the description box below. Okay, I just want to highlight some of the problems with the research that I'm going to talk about. So for starters, many of the studies on natural products for hair loss are very short studies. Some of them are just weeks, some of them are 6 months, and there is a good one that is 2 years that I will talk about later, but you know, they don't test for a very long period of time. A test is more reliable if it undergoes a longer period of testing, whereas some of this research is just a matter of weeks. And as well, a lot of the research on natural products include very small sample sizes, and some of the articles mentioned in this don't even test on humans, they test on mice. And yes, mice can be reliable when it comes to understanding hair loss and testing hair products, but you know, it's still not being tested on a human, which is the more ideal thing to be tested on. All of these studies definitely warrant future research. So, number one, rosemary oil. This study on rosemary oil warrants future research, and I think it definitely is something that you should consider if you don't want to use minoxidil, maybe because you're worried about ingesting minoxidil and it becoming systemic and any side effects that may be associated with minoxidil because of that, or maybe some of you just can't handle the irritation from applying minoxidil topically, which I know is definitely the case for me. I could not use the liquid topical. However, I will say the foam topical, I had no issues with. This study was on 100 patients with androgenetic alopecia. So a topical rosemary lotion was tested in comparison to using 2% liquid minoxidil. And actually the interesting part of this study is that the rosemary oil was just as effective as the 2% liquid minoxidil, which I think is really interesting. So if you really don't want to use minoxidil, I would recommend trying out some type of rosemary oil. And this test, you know, I would say it's pretty reliable. It was done over a 6-month period with 100 patients, but obviously 6 months is still not that long in the grand scheme of things. Larger trials need to be done in order to confirm the efficacy of this. This is just one study, and this study clearly comes with many limitations. However, with that being said, if you cannot stand using minoxidil and you're looking for an alternative, then yes, you probably could try using some type of rosemary oil. But again, just be careful when applying oils topically to the scalp. You have to use some type of carrier oil to dilute the essential oil, because if you apply the essential oil directly to the scalp, that's just going to cause irritation. But for me personally, applying oils to the scalp just really flares up my dermatitis. I have tried it in the past and it just made my dermatitis really bad. If you don't have dermatitis, again, I think this is something that could be really useful, especially because the rosemary oil was less irritating than using the liquid topical minoxidil. So again, if you find minoxidil irritating, then this could be for you. Okay, and peppermint oil. Some people are claiming that it works and reference this study in order to justify putting it in their hair serum product that they're selling. This study says, "We found that peppermint oil remarkably promoted hair growth compared to SAJO and even faster than minoxidil without a significant change of body weight gain or food efficiency." So I just want to highlight that this study was only done for 4 weeks, and this is a study that was done on mice. And as I mentioned to you before, yes, mice can be very useful for testing hair products, but they also come with their limitations. And you know, a 4-week study isn't really that long in order to conclude that something is effective. I believe the study doesn't conclude that peppermint oil can actually be used for androgenetic alopecia. I believe it states that it has some type of hair growth properties that are similar to minoxidil. That's another thing that made me really annoyed when someone cited this as scientific evidence that peppermint oil is good for hair growth. You know, I'm skeptical, but you know, try it if you want to. I'm not trying to put anyone off trying these products. Try it if you want to.
So, Healthline notes, more research on the effects of peppermint essential oil on human hair is needed, and it should not be considered a cure for baldness or alopecia.
And the next one was pumpkin seed oil, and this wasn't applied topically. This is ingesting pumpkin seed oil in the form of a tablet. Basically, pumpkin seed oil has something that inhibits testosterone converting into DHT, and as we know, DHT is the thing that we believe causes hair to fall out, is our follicles sensitivity to DHT. So this study notes that taking 400 milligrams of pumpkin seed oil showed an increased hair count of 40 versus 10% with the placebo. However, the tablet also included other ingredients. Therefore, it's not very clear if it was the pumpkin seed oil by itself or the other ingredients combined with the pumpkin seed oil that generated these effects. This study was only a 24-week trial with only 76 patients. So again, I believe that this is something that probably warrants future research. If it actually works to stop testosterone converting into DHT, then this might be something that you want to look into, because obviously you don't want your testosterone converting into DHT, because that is gonna affect your hair loss at the level of the follicle. So yeah. And another oil that I see a lot of in regards to hair loss, and don't get me wrong, this is something that I have tried using for hair loss and hair growth before. You know, we all get sucked into using these oils and these products. I will link you to another video where Dr. Dre talks about this in more detail, but she basically says in her video that there is no scientific literature that supports castor oil for hair growth, which is probably why I couldn't find anything to talk to you guys about. I had to go to Dr. Dre to figure this one out. You know, I feel like people believe that castor oil works for hair because it does a very good job at coating the hair shaft and making it feel thicker and fuller, which gives you the illusion that your hair is healthy and that it's gained more density. But remember, this is only doing something at a superficial level. It's not going to the root of your hair problem. It's just superficial. Therefore, it's not necessarily going to help with your hair loss. If you guys have ever used castor oil, it's very thick and dense. And I believe that if you try to rub this into your scalp, you know, this could actually cause you more damage due to the fact that it's so thick. I did see a study in which castor oil had actually led to matting of the hair. You're gonna cause more damage to your hair if you end up getting it all stuck together and matted. So yeah, just be cautious about using castor oil. I've definitely used it on my eyelashes before, and if you want a fuller looking lash, then yeah, go for it. Castor oil will make your lashes appear more fuller. You know, I say, why not? Go for it. But it's not gonna help your hair if you are having actual hair loss problems. And the last one is saw palmetto. This is one ingredient that I researched and I actually found very interesting. So I'm gonna mention two different studies here in regards to saw palmetto. Study number one is a randomized double-blind control study, which is pretty much the gold standard of testing. Unfortunately, it was only done on a sample size of 26 males, but it's interesting. It said that 26 males with AGA treated with either 50 milligrams of oral sitosterol and 200 milligrams of saw palmetto or placebo daily resulted in 60% of patients with improved outcomes compared to 11% of the controls. And again, saw palmetto is interesting because it helps stop DHT binding to the hair follicle, which again is something that might be very useful if you're looking to help your hair at the level of the follicle. SP blocks nuclear uptake of DHT in target cells and decreases DHT binding to androgen receptors by approximately 50%, which is pretty good for something that is a natural product. So that was the first study, and here's another study that is definitely very interesting and worth considering, especially if you're someone who cannot tolerate the side effects of finasteride, which is a 5-alpha reductase inhibitor. So it stops, again, testosterone converting into DHT. So this one is really interesting if you're worried about side effects when it comes to using finasteride. You know, some people do report sexual side effects, but you know, side effects aren't supposed to be that common, although I see a lot of people reporting that they are having side effects, but I don't know if that's just them panicking. But anyways, if you can't tolerate finasteride, this study was a 24-month study, which is really good, and it had 100 patients. And it was a comparative study. So it was a comparison of saw palmetto versus finasteride. And both groups saw improvement in relation to their hair loss. The saw palmetto saw a 38% improvement in their hair loss, whereas the finasteride group saw a 68% improvement in their hair loss. Even though the finasteride group had more dramatic results, 38% for a product that didn't have any side effects is still very good. And you know, I think this is something definitely worth considering. It's something that I am going to look into potentially taking, and it will be something that I will discuss with my doctor whenever I do eventually get to see her, because you know, I found it pretty interesting. If you have androgenetic alopecia and you don't want to take finasteride, then maybe saw palmetto might be something that is worth looking into. I just want you to guys to remember that these natural products, when we use them for hair loss, you have to be really careful when using them, because you need to make sure that you are ingesting the correct dosage, and you need to make sure that you're applying things carefully. Make sure you're using some type of carrier oil to protect yourself from the harshness of putting oils on your scalp. And you know, if done incorrectly, you can cause scalp inflammation, which can lead to further hair loss down the line. So that is something that I want you to be careful with when seeking alternative methods. And as noted, a lot of studies out there on natural products, they're not double-blind, randomized, placebo-controlled trials. The way in which they're being tested is questionable and warrants a lot more stringent research in order to make sure that we are getting more reliable results and, you know, people aren't being led the wrong way. If someone is trying to sell you a hair growth oil on YouTube and they're claiming that it's backed by science, you know, just be cautious of the science. You have to remember, just because something is scientific, it doesn't mean that it's factual. Some of the samples are not big enough, some of the trials are not long enough, some of the trials are not done on humans, and some of them are not the gold standard of testing. And some people don't disclose who is funding the experiment. So you guys really need to be skeptical when people claim things are backed by science. Yeah, it just really upsets me when people use and abuse science in order to, you know, sell products, promote their agenda, and just prey on other people's vulnerability and the fact that they may not understand the science. And you know, with that being said, I am no scientist, so you have to be skeptical of everything that I say on YouTube as well, because I'm not a scientist, I'm just someone on YouTube. But I spent a long time going through the literature and trying my best to really understand what these tests were actually saying in regards to using natural products, because I want to protect other people who are going through hair loss, you know, and I want to be that guide for those of you who don't necessarily know what you're doing when it comes to hair loss. With that being said, you know, I really hope that natural products undergo more testing, because at the end of the day, I don't want us to be just stuck with minoxidil, finasteride, spironolactone. I want us to have other alternative ways for treating hair loss. And I really do believe that one day we are probably going to uncover something. Just remember, minoxidil was accidentally discovered. It was originally a medication for blood pressure, but then people started to note that they were growing their hair back. And then we started to use it as a medication for hair growth, for hair loss. So who knows what we are going to discover down the line. I'm really hoping that we do discover better alternatives, and maybe alternatives where people aren't so worried about the side effects. And ultimately, everything that you do in regards to your hair is completely up to you. Only you are going to be looking out for your hair. You're the only person who is going to fix your hair loss. Nobody else is going to do that. People will prey on your vulnerability and people will try to take advantage of you, because that is just how the world works. That is how people make money. As I say, be skeptical of everything, do your own research, just do what is best for you. And that is the best advice I can give you guys. If you're curious, I recently just made a video about 5 hair mistakes that I made when trying to grow my hair back, which I think might be really useful, because it also talks a lot about supplements and shampooing, etc. So I think if you guys like this video, you might enjoy that video too. As with everything, I will link the studies that I've looked at in the description below so you guys can check them out for yourself. If you found the video helpful, then do be sure to give it a like. And if you're enjoying the content, be sure to subscribe to my channel. You guys know that I try to post hair content whenever I think it's relevant. Just keep that in mind. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.